Good morning and welcome to the 15th edition of Energy Prospectives. As you already know, this is a joint program between the Naturgy Foundation and IESE. Of course, energy is the business of Naturgy, and it is essential, and it is its essential field. But we at IESE decided very early that to join soon, because we recognize that the decarbonization of the economy and its impact in energy would be of interest and will be decisive for all industry. So today is renewable energies. We have prominent speakers, and the normal design of the session is to have afterwards a debate about that. The Energy Prospective has been a meeting point for business people from the energy industry, of course, but from many other ones, a meeting point also for scientists, experts, and public administration officers. And the objective of the session, as in all the previous editions, is to help everybody to have a better and clearer idea about the subject. As I already know, we have two prominent speakers today that will be properly introduced by Francesco La Camera, a chairman of Naturgy, and at this point I take the advantage to say thank you to Mr. Reynes for his permanent support with this event in the different editions, and also in order to finish, I will express also our gratitude to Naturgy Foundation and its president Rafael Villaseca, who will address the closing remarks of these sessions. Oh, Paco, it is your turn.
Muy bien. Buenos días a todos. Good morning. First of all, I want to thank you all of you to be here. And I have been said that there are over 500 people connected through the internet webcasting session, which it demonstrates the most important thing is that this Energy Prospectives, after its 15th edition, has become one of the reference in energy topics. And as it could not be on a different way, the energy topic of today is probably the topic around the energy. You know? I want to thank you first, IESE, and Professor José Luis Suárez, because I think that thanks to IESE we have achieved two important things. One is that the amount of people, of relevant people that can be with us in these sessions, it demonstrates that we chose the right partner. And thanks to the foundation that they have included in this program enough relevant topics as per the audience is demonstrating. And thank to both Rafael Villaseca as chairman and José Luis Suárez in the name of IESE. For Naturgy, it's always a pleasure to speak about energy. It's our business. And the more than about energy is known, the more than people understand us and knows us. We have one important objective mission in our industry, in our company, is trying to deliver energy to our clients in the best manner. And what that best manner means? We think that it must be an equilibrium between three important objectives, what we have called solving the energy trilemma. Number one is clearly securing energy supply, which means that every of us should have access to energy on a very stable basis and being sure that energy is guaranteed. Number two is advancing on decarbonization. I think that there is no doubt around the, I'm sure, the 500 people connected that we need to do something to fight for the climate change, and decarbonization is one of the topics. And point number three, doing that under the umbrella that should be achieved through affordable prices, because people should be prepared, clients should be in a mood to pay the right price. Today, we have the topic exclusively about renewables. And to talk about renewables, it's very difficult to get the support of most relevant people as we have today. From one side, the managing director of IRENA is the International Agency for Renewables energies in the world. I mean, Francesco La Camera, very reputed person that I'm sure that will delight us with important statistics about what renewables are achieving. But more important than that, as we discussed yesterday night with Francesco, the most important thing is to convince us that we are in the right trend. We have the abilities to achieve what we want to do. And the reasons why we want to do are clearly for everyone. And point number two, we have also Arnaud de Giovanni, which is a very high reputed worldwide consultant on renewables as well. I'm pretty convinced that they will fight each other with some different arguments, because both, as we are Spanish, they are Italians, Latin character, hot blood. But the most important thing is that we have experts, because the problem about renewables is everyone speaks about renewables, but there are more speakers than really strong knowledgers. And today we have the pleasure to have two of them, one of the most reputed in the world. I think that I should stop, because you are here is to listen to them and not to me. Then thank you both to come here. Thank you both for your passion and your encouragement in supporting this transition that the world needs to face. And probably you are today with one of the companies, Naturgy, that has been trying in the last years to demonstrate that we are really committed towards these objectives. Naturgy, as you know, is a 180 years old company, one of the oldest companies that we have in Spain, that has demonstrated its resilience by transforming itself through the years. It could not be possible to achieve the 180 years of age without being transforming in a world that has been transformed in the last two centuries, but at the same time understands and is committed to continue transforming towards the world we need. And energy is our business, and transformation is really our soul. Then I hope that both speakers will delight you, and thank you again to Foundation Naturgy, Fundación Naturgy and IESE to make it possible. It has become one of the reference dialogues that we have in the world. Thank you both, and hope you will enjoy with this session today again.
Right here. Okay. Without much further ado, I would move to our speakers. We're gonna start with Francesco first. Please, Francesco, take the podium. We have about 20, 25 minutes to listen to him. We're gonna do the same with Arnaud. But then, of course, if questions come up already, feel free to write them down, and they will be sent to me.
Thank you. Thank you, and happy to be here with you. Quindi, so buongiorno a tutti. We gather to address a critical mission. It's the energy transition and the urgent needs for renewable energy adoption. I should have some slides. I think if you can put it, so I have to do something. Oh, there's my, I can do it. So first, a few words on our agency, the International Renewable Energy. Our mandate is very simple. Our task is promoting all forms of renewables energy worldwide. And we stand today at a critical crossroads, as we may already been listening from the words of people that has been presented this section. And in our outlook, we as IRENA, we publish every year an outlook, and we are trying to make the outlook be a kind way to a kind of way to monitor the progress that we are that we have in the energy transition show that the 1.5 goal of the Paris Agreement in principle is still achievable, but we really need an urgent shift and a course correction. So last year we have experimented a new record in installed capacity. You know that is important to mention, and here in the slide you see IRENA what is engaged. So we have our knowledge base publication. You know, when the IRENA was established, still there was people thinking that renewables were just a niche. No? So we have a work on showing how renewables we are becoming cheaper and cheaper, and how is the cheapest way to produce electricity in large part of the world. And we have our publication showing how the installed capacity of renewable has been accelerating its path year after year, and you will see a very clear slide on that. And now we are also focusing on trying to bring our capacity to be present in all our member states, that today are 170, including the European Union, trying to support them in their planning, especially the countries in the least developed country, in the small islands, and so take profit of this capacity to support the country, working together with them, to not only on the planning side, but also in the implementation side through projects. So these are the main area of the activity of the agency. And here we see the slides on the installed capacity. That's it speak by itself. If you can see along the year, how from being a niche is becoming the dominant installed capacity per year recently. And last year, we had a record of 473 gigawatts. This means some 60% more than the previous year. And the 87% of new installed capacity last year was renewables. Just to give you the sense of how this is relevant in terms of scaling up, I like to make an example with nuclear. No? If you look how much gigawatts of nuclear we have installed in the world, in the last 70 years, you will discover that 371 gigawatts. So in 1 year, renewables have installed more power capacity than nuclear in the last 70 years. This gives the sense that for us it's important to transmit that is the only technology today that can be deployed in a time that is consistent with the achievement of the Paris Agreement goals. You know, all of us, we say that we believe in science, and if we believe in science, it means that we want to stay on a coherent pathway for getting for containing the rising of the temperature by 1.5 at the end of the century. We have to reduce CO2 emission by 43% already in 2030. If we don't do in time, we have no possibility to go back. So climate is a very strange animal. Sometimes if you don't do something today, we can do tomorrow. This is not for climate. If you don't reduce the emission by a certain quantity at a certain moment, there will no possibility to recover. So the damage is done and will remain there for years and years and years. So, and what we have said in our outlook, that getting this 43% of reduction means that we need to have at 2030 11 terawatts of renewable energy installed capacity. This means that the study has been feeding the process of COP28, where one of the main outcomes was this pledge on tripling renewable energy standard capacity, meant last year to install 1,000 gigawatts from last year to 2030 to get the 11 terawatts. The fact is that the record is there, but the record is half short on what we needed. This means that you have to be more ambitious in the year to come. Another aspect that we may mention here is that not only we have fall short on what we needed, but also the progress is quite unequal. So China has been pulling, doubling their yearly installed capacity last year, 2023. So they did two times what they did in 2022. And this has helped the world to increase their renewable installed capacity. And the other part of the world, you see, G7 country, G20 country. But if you look at Africa, you see the disparity that is there. So everyone is talking about a transition that should be fair and inclusive, but the reality is that we are leaving someone behind us. So it's important that we accelerate the speed and the scale of our path, but also try to provide for a more equal approach to that. And we see now about Europe. And we know that the European Union is negotiating a new binding renewable target for 2030 to a minimum of 42.5%, up from the previous 32% target, with the aspiration to reach 45%. And the continent has also saw 10% expansion in capacity, reaching 71 gigawatts. But for achieving its climate goal, the European Union needs innovative green extensions, interconnection, need market restructuring, and sector coupling approach for electrification. Implementing coordinated planning amongst authorities on infrastructure development and economic incentives for smart electrification and demand-side response. Ensure robust policy and regulatory framework for energy efficiency. Europe initiatives mark significant progress in this respect. We have seen a couple of months ago this agreement between the northern country for ensuring the harmonization of their grid system to allow all the potential of the North Baltic Sea of offshore wind to be able to reach Europe. We have seen these agreements from Portugal, Spain, France, and Germany. We have to see also the implementation of the agreement for having this interconnection going on. Because without connecting, the transition will not be there. So it's important we understand that one of the first challenges that we have is absolutely providing the infrastructure, the ensure interconnectivity, flexibility, and balancing of the grid. So one other aspect of the COP28 that has been defined as historical for this was this call of the transitioning from fossil fuel. In fact, what we have experimented after the COP28 in Dubai, that this is not happening. And we have lots of investment still going to the old sector. And this is something that we are very worried about. We have been calling in our outlook, say, look, we were supposed to install 1,000 gigawatts per year to be in line to our goal at 2030. Now we have to install 50 gigawatts more per year. And if we don't do this, that means the double of the previous year. And if we don't do this, we have to install more capacity in 2025. So it's like that's a car that has to keep an average every year to get from one town to another. And if the average is not respected, it's becoming, in the remaining hours of your travel, you have to accelerate more and more and more. At a certain moment, physically, you cannot get there. So it's important to understand that if we don't really make this course correction now, we already cannot think about keeping the 1.5 alive, and also the 2 degrees goal is already at risk. So it is important, and as is important that we provide that this investment that we need should go in the right direction. This means also, as we say, to try to be working for a more equal approach, especially to Africa and Southeast Asia, because this area is not just a question of charity, of fairness, or justice, that are important. But it's also a question of the fact that we need to capture the area where the energy demand is growing, and we suppose will be growing in the next year. Because if we don't intercept that increase in the demand, everything will go out of control. So it's important that we concentrate the efforts for having all world investing in the clean energy system. There is also another aspect. There is not only concentration on the geographical area, but there is also concentration on the technologies. So now what we do is especially wind and solar, but I think we need to enlarge the spectrum of the technologies that we are using in the renewable, because renewables are an holistic system that's where every technology help the other one to succeed. This is our projection on what we need in terms of different technologies in 2030. So how the 11 terawatt of the 11,000 gigawatts should be declined in the different technologies there. But so there is no doubt, and the NABA say that we need a course correction now. What we were discussing yesterday in our dinner is important that we set the context of all our we are doing. Because if we go out of this context, we are not serving the cause. So if we say that climate change is a reality, if we say yes, we must achieve the Paris Agreement goal, because if the temperature will increase more than that, this will damage profoundly our way and to live and our system. So this is the point. If we believe in science, and we all say yes, especially in a building like this, we have to believe in science, no? And if science that for getting these goals, we have to reduce emission at a certain speed and scale, everything that is out of being in this border is not serving the cause. So it's not something that really is focusing on finding a solution. So this should be clear in my point of view. And all we are experimenting that scaling up renewables until we get a certain share of renewables could be, say, quite easy. But when we start to have 35-40% of renewables into the system, it's becoming a little bit more complicated. And this brings me to what I started to say in commenting the first slide of this presentation. We as IRENA, we are trying to understand why renewables is the cheapest way to produce power today in large part of the world. It's the cleanest, so it's perfectly in line with the achievement of Paris goal. Now people has understood that it's also the most secure way to supply energy. I think the recent crisis make clear that an old centralized energy system based on fossil fuel is not a guarantee for energy security as was thought years ago. Now everyone is agreeing that having a decentralized energy system makes the market functioning better, and it's the best way also to ensure energy security when you have more provider and not just a few. So, and also investment in renewables, they provide three times jobs than in the conventional fossil fuel sector. So if it's good for the environment, it's good for the economy, for the social aspect, if it's good for security, why we are not running more than we are already running? And we think that we need to overcome barriers that are there, because we just thought that the energy system needs to be sustained, doesn't stand alone. What does it mean? That if gas should arrive to my home in Sicily from Libya, we need to have something that brings the gas from there to my place. This means that I need infrastructure. I need a legal system that allow for that. And then we have also the skills to bring the gas, put in a pipeline, build the pipeline, bring in my house. So we need all things together. And we took more than 100 years to build and we still left 700 million people without electricity to make the system work. So the first thing, you have to sustain the system, provide the infrastructure that make possible to exchange this good. And we have also to have a legal environment that provided for that. And we need to have the capacity. Means also the university course and also the school here, no? So we have been forming professionals to serve the existing system. But now we are starting and we have to rush informing the professionals that may serve the new system that is coming. And if you talk with companies, they also may say that, as they say to us, that they wish to invest more, but they don't have the skilled workforce to put more power on the ground. So we think that these three main barriers are relevant. And I also learned yesterday in this chat that we had how important also from your side, the policy aspects. The market is not today favorable for renewables. And this is happening in Europe. And if we know that we can rely only on the market in itself, because for sure if we rely only on the market, the change will happen. So I always say that the English speak people like to say that there is no doubt on what is the direction of travel. We are going to a new energy system that will be largely dominated by renewables, complemented by hydrogen, mainly green hydrogen, and bioenergy. This will happen. The question again, and the market will bring us there. The question, it will bring us there in time. So it's where we need policies. Policy means permitting. Policy make market design, means how we make contract. All these kind of things has to be there, and they have to be now, if we want really to have a result. Another aspect that, and then I will try to close, because being too long is always not a good thing to do, is the role of multilateral financial institution in all this. You know that there is a debate about the reform of the multilateral financial institutions. There is a demand for having this institution having more inclusive decision-making process, perhaps provide for more grant and concessional loans. In my point of view, this aspect of a reform of the multilateral financial institution are relevant, but also, I think that we have to need to have a clear focus on what this organization or entities are doing. And I always give the example of the after Second World War. If Europe was not able to receive the support that we receive with the Marshall Plan, Europe would be not as it stands today. So we have to understand that continent as Africa, Southeast Asia, they need a kind of reviewing the way we are supporting them. And for me, the infrastructure is the first priority in that part of the world, as in Europe. Again, on my opinion. So I think that the multilateral financial institution should be see together the development and the building of the new energy system. So they have to give priority to strengthening and building the infrastructure that is needed in Africa and in Southeast Asia. Everyone says that Africa is the most important powerhouse for clean energy, for green hydrogen. But how they can benefit themselves, how we can benefit from this if we don't have the capacity to let us importing and trading the clean energy. We think that linking Europe with North Africa for a better integration is the way to ensure development in Africa, but it's also important for Europe to keep its competitiveness and enhance its competitiveness. And in this respect, green hydrogen is important. But when we talk about hydrogen, we have to understand that this is an area where policies are extremely relevant. Spain could be a small powerhouse for green hydrogen for Europe. Italy could be a platform in the Mediterranean to link Europe with the African continent. But we have to do things working together. And without policies that may create or enhance the demand for green hydrogen, this integration will not happen. So again, policies is absolutely important in this respect. We need also new way for ensuring cooperation and support with Africa and Southeast Asia. We, as IRENA, we have launched this idea of an accelerating partnership for Africa and renewables. This has been in our way an important way to reshape the way the cooperation may work, because it's based on a plan that the African country may prepare themselves without support. is very important the ownership of the planning for the African country. They've been subject in the past to a predatory approach. So sometimes they are not so many, so confident on the kind of support they may receive. But if we are working together, as we are trying to do with this partnership, we are building with the country, they are planning, and then we have a country like Germany, Denmark, UAE, United States from now. I have also requested other countries to join from the Developed World Digital Alliance. We perhaps we can better functioning and trying to have a new way for enhance the cooperation, make cooperation that really works. So what I wish to send as final message here, that we have to be clear on the fact that we have a limited time to get the result that we wish to have. And if we leave this time passing by without getting the result, the risk is the heavy impact on the quality of our life, on the possibility of our economic system to provide the benefit that we are still enjoying. So climate change is not a joke. It's something real, and we have to focus and understand that is the first menace for our world, and we have to make any efforts, also if it's difficult. You know, we all understand that we have to start it 20 years ago, but we did not. Not at the speed that was needed. Now there is no time, really. The numbers say to us this very clear. We feel also the responsibility to say very clear to the world, say that the multilateral agency as IRENA have to send positive message. Okay, that's the only positive message that we think is positive is say the reality. In our point of view, we are very close to lose the 1.5. And we are very close to put at risk the 2 Celsius degrees. This is the message that I want to send to you today and say very clear that we still have the chance for doing, but really we have to run. Grazie molto.
Grazie Francesco, thank you. We pass the baton to Arnaud.
Is it working?
As we're setting this up, I will remind everybody that we can ask questions. I'm receiving some questions from people online in the tablet already. Feel free to keep them coming, also from the room. On that note, I think Arnaud, you can take it away.
Yeah, excellent. So it's working? Yeah, perfect. So hello, everyone. So as Massimo was saying, my name is Arnaud de Giovanni. I have the pleasure to have created and lead EY Global Renewables team. So coming from a slightly different perspective from Francesco's presentation, I'm also half Italian. So we're kind of, you know, that's why Francesco was saying we're kind of a bunch of Latin people presenting. I'm going to, of course, I agree with everything Francesco was saying, but I'm going to come from a slightly different perspective. Of course, you know, IRENA and EY are two very different organizations. Try to look at, in terms of countries, not sort of, you know, globally, but in terms of countries where the efforts have been made and actually walk you through one of our publications, which is a publication we're very proud of, which we've been running for 20 years. There aren't that many things that have been constant at EY or any other consulting firm for 20 years. So we're very proud of this one. So I think that's working. So I think we're sharing, you know, the big numbers, 11 terawatt. That's one of the outcome of the COP. In our model, it's the same. But I think if you look at the other lines to the right of the slide, you actually can see that it's what we call the accelerated scenario, right? That gets us to 12 gigawatt. In case we do not accelerate, and acceleration, we have written it in the footnote, not to kind of scare everybody, but maybe we should. This means industry and government collaborate to beat the agreed target and commit to make significant changes. And you know, as was explained before, it's not completely the case yet, although I think we can all agree that the willingness is here. If we don't do that, you know, we have the 2 degree, which is just short of 9 terawatt. And if we go, I think the scary one is the yellow one, which is if we continue the same efforts, we'll be well short of 6 gigawatts, so roughly half of what is needed and what everyone has committed to. So that's, and that I think I would draw your attention to one of the numbers, and everyone has different numbers, but what is important is the ballpark. It's the $2.5 trillion investment per year between now and 2030. And interestingly, I was on a panel at LSE a couple of years ago with a friend from BlackRock who was saying, you know, the money is there. Not all, you know, in the funds, but the money is there. But what we're missing is good projects. And so that's a little bit what, you know, I think it has improved, but that's a little bit what I'm going to try to walk you through in the next couple of pages. That, I mean, we have roughly the same view. I think one thing that I would draw your attention towards is how wind and solar now are almost on the same size, you know, from a global perspective, but how actually in 2030, especially in the accelerated trajectory, which is the one we should all aim for, solar is going to be roughly 50% above wind being aggregated onshore and offshore. So I think it's actually quite interesting to see the development of solar. Back to what I was telling you about in terms of the publication, we call it RECAI, which for us, it's a really well-known word, but it means Renewable Energy Country Attractiveness Index. So the objective is not to give good grades and bad grades to countries and everything, but it's to put ourselves from an investor perspective. And you know, I'm sure a lot of you are investors or interested in investing, and essentially understand in what countries the policy, in what countries the market, in what country the macroeconomic factors. I'll deep dive into that in a second. What countries are more renewable energy friendly, but what is important is also what country goes up and what country goes down. Because I think this is, you know, and I will tell you a couple of, you know, funny stories later. So that's why we publish twice a year. It hasn't been always twice a year. That's why it's 20 years and 62 editions. But, and the way we do it, I mean, not to bore you with that, but it's just it's always an equilibrium between qualitative and quantitative. So we have people in every country that are the champions of this publication, and they essentially mix the qualitative and the quantitative data set. There's gazillions of data, and at the end we have 5 pillars, so we rank the criteria where we assess, and again it's not a distribution of good grades, the countries, and I'll deep dive into that. And we'll see how Spain, I suspect Spain is interesting for you, maybe not only, but it's an interesting country. So I'll deep dive into how Spain is doing, and more importantly, has been doing over time. So macroeconomic, energy imperative, this is kind of the security of supply, policy enablement, and this is why we work, you know, closely with Francesco and his colleagues as well. Project delivery and the potential for technology. And you will see that some countries are extremely well ranked in one specific technology, but because they do not progress all the technologies together, they, you know, are not so well ranked. So this is the ranking. It's free on the internet. So, and probably, yeah, it's a And as you will see, Spain is the number 8, and it's blue. That means that it has been number 8 last time as well. So this one we published in November 23, and we publish every year in May and in November, roughly. So interestingly, you know, I was saying I will tell you a few funny stories. So China has been number 1 or number 2 for a number of years. Another number 3, but more funnily, the first time US was number 1 and then was knocked off number 1, we got two US partners who got summoned in the US Congress to explain why the US was no longer number 1. So, I mean, we were quite happy with that, probably less happy for our US colleagues, but they had to explain. And so people are looking at that, including in the government, et cetera, et cetera. So following up a little bit on what Francesco was saying, we do not have enough global South countries in there. It's better than a few years ago, but we do not have enough. And I think, you know, I will show you another ranking in a second, where we have a little bit more, because there's a problem of size, because obviously size is important in this ranking, because the bigger you are, the more you can promote and develop renewable energy. But also, you know, the Africa, but also Southeast Asia, also Latin America. I mean, we have Chile here, and I'm sure we have Brazil somewhere, but and Argentina, actually. Yeah, we have Brazil number 19 and Argentina 29 and Mexico 35. But interestingly, it needs to be more of a just transition, and, you know, no pun intended, but that was one of the themes of COP28, you know, just energy transition. And of course, as everyone understood, it was just, you know, you just have to do it, but just, you know, it has to be just for everyone. This is when I was telling you about the various technology rankings. And, you know, the good example is India. I mean, I don't know if some of you have looked into renewables energy in India or invested in renewable energy in India, but solar is king, and wind is actually on the back burner. We have put offshore wind as well, because this is where, you know, I know there's a lot of debate here in Spain on offshore wind, and, you know, it's kind of nascent, but it's not so bad. I mean, based on our analysis, you guys in Spain are ranked number 20, which means that there's a huge potential for improvement when offshore wind is up and running. And I see my colleague smiling, because we have a lot of debates on offshore wind in Spain, actually. Another story I was telling you, I would tell you. So last, I think about a year ago or 2 years ago, we published our ranking, you know, and this became a little bit of a habit. And we got from a very close country to Spain, one very public fight picked up on LinkedIn saying, EY, what are you doing? You know, the country, it was Portugal. We do everything we can, you know, and we are always number, I don't know what they were, 17 or something, or around 20th position. And so, you know, you must be doing something wrong, etc., etc. Actually, it got us thinking, because, you know, it's not because you've been doing something for the last 20 years that it has to be right. And I would even say the contrary. It is probably because you've been doing something for the last 20 years that you need to look at it with a fresh eye. So we did this size adjusted one, which is actually quite interesting, because then you have Denmark, Morocco and Greece topping the charts, which obviously are three smaller countries than the US, China, Germany, etc., etc. So in this, unfortunately, Spain is a bit lower than in our normal ranking, but it shows that, you know, everything is a little bit relative, obviously. and listening to what people on the ground are saying is very important. So if anyone has any comments on any countries or any new ideas, obviously this is a living thing. So, you know, I think we have a time to socialize a little bit afterwards. Be very happy to hear your suggestions. I promise this is the last ranking I'm showing, but this is very important as well, not only because Spain is number two, but this is a very important topic in the development of renewable energy, is the corporate PPA. And we see corporate PPAs appearing everywhere in the world. You know, some countries changing their regulation to make corporate PPA possible and then to encourage them. And so, so we publish also a specific corporate PPA index where Spain has been number one for a couple of issues, and you've been knocked off the first slot by Germany just last time. But I mean, you know, it doesn't really matter. It's a great country for corporate PPA. It doesn't mean that there's no obstacle and there's no flip sides and everything. But I mean, it's just trying to recognize this. And this index in particular is quite important when some of the fund managers, et cetera, are trying to allocate their capital in the countries, because obviously corporate PPA is an important part of financing of those renewable projects. Oh, now I got this. So this is how it has evolved over time. And as you see, the first seven countries, which you have on the right, US, Germany, China, mainland, because we report Taiwan separately, France, Australia, India, UK, have been, and I think there's one that I'm missing, have been always in the top seven. Spain is doing a really good progression. And as we're going to see here, so back in May 19, when you guys were number 16, it has consistently gone up. And it has also consistently gone up in what we call the normalized rank, which is the size adjusted thing I was talking about. And PPA, well, one or two, I mean, I think it's actually quite good. And you see below the technology ranking. I was saying, you know, all the technologies are important, but it can be obviously very deliberate for a country to say, you know, we privilege this technology versus the other. It plays to the natural strength of the country, et cetera, et cetera. But so here, obviously, solar, onshore wind, you know, even CSP, where Spain was one of the precursors, all of that contributes to a good ranking. So here, it's quite interesting because it's always good to look at what's, you know, below the lid, right, below the surface, and saying on the non-technology metrics. So macro fundamentals, you know, could do better in our ranking, but I could also say other countries are doing better. So, you know, the stable economy, the good business environment, I think that, you know, tax is obviously part of this ranking. The energy imperative, I think, you know, what is well recognized, and this is where I was saying at the beginning, you know, it's a mix and match of qualitative and quantitative criteria. This is exactly where the qualitative criteria apply. So your low reliance on fossil fuel, the fact that, you know, the grid has been adapted to cover renewables. I mean, you know, everywhere we have to do things, but it's quite important. So all of that is recognized here, and so is the policy, the ambition, and the project delivery, as we call it, which is, you know, it's what I was saying before. Do you have multiple routes to getting a project done? Do you have, you know, how encouraged is the corporate PPA market, etc., etc.? I think that's it. And of course, I have to finish with the call to 11 terawatt, which I think everyone has on their slides at the moment. But it's very important. I think as EY, we are part of a few industry bodies as well, which supports that in, you know, various ways, shapes or form. I don't think we open to question. You will open to question, Matthew.
Yes,
right?
Absolutely. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Arnaud. Merci. Merci beaucoup. Grazie mille.
Prego.
All right, we have about an hour for a conversation to develop a little bit some of the themes. I want to start from one that seems to be, well, there's actually two that seems to be on the mind. We have a little music.
We have the music first.
For a little ambience. There's a couple of themes that seems to be on the minds of everybody. There's just some people that are willing to bring them up and some people that seem to keep in the back of their mind. But so let me go back to the 11 terawatt, right? So to get there, it's pretty clear that we've done a lot in 2023. We still have to do a lot. It's pretty clear that we need private money because it's a huge investment that is needed. So the good news, I think, as Francesco was mentioning, is that renewables, especially onshore wind and solar utility scale, are the cheapest way to produce electricity. So in some sense, we're expecting private money to go there. Globally, there's a lot to do. But in specific markets, such as, for instance, Spain, these days there's a lot of debate, we seem to be to a point where prices have gone to single digit in wholesale markets. Of course, cost of capital has gone up as well. So there seems to be a concern that just the market conditions might not be conducive to seeing a sustaining investment as we've seen in the last few years. So just the market conditions might be a barrier in certain markets, not globally, but in certain markets, to accelerating or to continue on this path that we need, right? So I guess the question for you here is, do you see this as a concern? And if so, what can we do on the short term to make sure private money keeps flowing into renewables in markets that are already quite developed? Here in Spain, more than 50% of installed capacity is in renewables. Production is more or less along those lines. Are we going to hit a wall? Or are we going to make sure we can sort of try to continue on the path that we've been seeing also in developed markets? We'll be talking about less developed markets later on, but there seems to be a concern in the room about what's happening here.
So if naturally is a matter of concern, there is no doubt. Naturally, we avoid if no request by government to give our opinion on what they have to do. So I can respond in general and not referring to Spain. This is a problem that we are observing in many countries, especially for the wind and offshore wind. What we are trying to say in my presentation is that the market today doesn't take into account the fact that renewables have very high upfront costs, so the investment costs, and very low management costs, operational costs. This, what does it mean? It means that fixing the price following the cost marginal rules, it doesn't work for renewables. It brings the price at the level that make investing in renewables not to be convenient. So what we have called in our work is already to try to make the market work differently. So when we talk about supply of electricity, we need to talk about long-term contract. The action cannot be just a competition price, because this depressing the price and bringing where we are now in many countries. So the first things to do is trying to intervene in the design of the market and make the markets be more favorable for renewables.
No, I think I will give the my answer will be a little bit from a market perspective. I think the good news is that the markets adapt. They adapt quickly and they can adapt to pretty much, you know, every change, every development. So yes, I mean, returns are falling, especially they're falling and they have fallen quite low in countries which have been the first one to embrace renewable energy. This is, you know, the winner's curse in a way. But I think the good news is that at the same time, you've had an increasing population of investors in renewable energy and, more importantly, a differentiating population of investors. So I didn't want to bore you with too many slides, but we have one where we show 5 years ago where, you know, I'm talking mostly financial investors, but not only, where all the financial investors were seeking or accepting operational risk. So they would never have gone into construction risk, let alone development risk. If we do the slide now, which we have done, if we chart or the chart, we see that there's, you know, there is a good operating construction development risk mix for pretty much, which is different from pretty much one investor to the next. So what I guess I'm trying to say is that the investor population, they're adapting to those decreasing returns. I mean, it is problematic for strategic buyers, but they are all strategic investors, but there are ways they are coping with that as well. And also what you see is new investors getting into renewables. Of course, nobody wants to lose money into doing that or not getting the return they're supposed to get. But sometimes they also have, you know, it's mixed, it's balanced by other criteria. I can give you an example, which is quite old, actually. It's probably 15 years ago. I was 15 years younger, and I was running. I used to work for various banks, various investment banks, and I was running a sell side of a pan-European renewable developer, and suddenly a company calls me, and I can't name too many companies, so a retail company, let's say, okay? So retail and investment in renewable energy, nothing to do, it was like 2007, probably more than 15 years ago. And they say, Arno, you have forgotten me on your buyers list. I say, no, you are a retail company, why would you buy wind farms? And actually, they bought, now they have 1.5 gigawatt of renewable assets, I mean, wind farms, solar farms, that they own. It's not contracts, it's not corporate PPA, they own 1.5 gigawatt of renewable producing assets. So, you know, there's a lot of adaptation, there's a lot of making it work despite an environment that obviously everyone would like to have better returns in some countries, and we have not yet started to talk about other countries, so which you will get into, I'm sure, Massimo.
Yeah, so I mean, my takeaways is that there's still a lot to do somewhere else, somehow, right? There is a class of investors that might be adapting and trying to find ways to make the current conditions work. But at the end of the day, right, the fundamental is that we need some sort of market redesign in order to make this sustainable above a certain threshold. Yeah,
because we, at least from our point of observation, too many come to us say that we cannot manage. So. And it's also in many European countries, there is a request to do something urgently, because we have the wind energy that has been a leading industry in the world, European. So we cannot lose this the field where we are preeminent. So we have to be very careful because the changing are happening fast. And naturally, the market may adapt fast. But there is a moment where we need policies that make the market working better. There is no doubt. And Europe that has a problem of keep their our competitiveness as Europe. So we have to be very careful that this adjustment will not bring out our industries from the world market. So we have to be very careful. And the main complaining are coming from the offshore wind industries. So they cannot afford action where there is zero price or negative price. There could be adjustments, but we cannot lose the preeminence that we have in certain sector. Mm-hmm. We cannot.
Yeah, at the end of the day, the evolution of the sector is always a co-evolution between regulation, policy, technology, and fundamentals. So in many ways, the three have to work harmonically. Otherwise, of course, the system might not.
Yes, also the way we do the auction, because at the end the decreasing prices because we abandoned the feed-in tariff and we went to auction. Now the auction are mainly based on price, but we can have more qualification in the auction. For example, we have seen some hybrid auction in India, for example, where I put solar and wind together. Where they put renewables, but they put also storage together. So we have to try to understand how we can make the system work better, because the changes are happening. But again, the question that we have that everything has to happen at a certain moment, unfortunately, if you want to keep the raising of the temperature low, as we all wish.
Very clear. Some questions relate to the other side of the story, right, which is that technological side, specifically related to storage, because of course the spread between the night price and the day price might be lowered by storage solutions. It's unclear whether current battery costs are low enough to make arbitraging profitable, but perhaps we're gonna get there. Short-term storage anyway seems to have some sort of solution more or less in sight using the current technologies. Longer-term storage, of course, seems to be a little bit more of a question mark to these days. I think, Francesco, I like how you say, we believe in science. So at some point, the end point is clear. No, we're going to get there. I guess more of the question mark is, so what's in between the end point and today, right? So how are we going to manage our systems in such a way that the system will stay stable, will provide power, will conduce, of course, us through the transition, but at the same time will make sort of the system work as we sort of still missing a few perhaps technological solutions for instance, those weeks where we have no wind for weeks or up to sometimes months, right? How are we gonna manage that from a technological side? What's your sense about the future?
I think that's a part of the, part of the problem of some of the storage solutions that exist now is the cost. Because they are new technologies. I mean, I don't want to talk about the elephant in the room, which is hydrogen, that everyone, we have been quite not talking about hydrogen in both our presentations, but it's obviously a storage solution. It's obviously a way also to transport electricity. And this is something that we see more and more globally, people gearing up for that. Of course, there's nothing ready, fully ready, or there's nothing that is completely cost efficient, that's for sure. But maybe I'm too much of a believer in markets. But if we look at, when what we now call the traditional renewable energy started, and it was very expensive, it had to be subsidized, etc. And everyone was counting on decrease in prices. And actually, that's also what we were discussing last night. The decrease was quicker than people were anticipating. So I think, for hydrogen and for some of the other storage solutions, it's a little bit the same, certainly, that I expect, and fortunately, I'm not the only one, to have a quicker decrease than planned. But if you already look at what is expected, you know, in terms of decrease in green hydrogen cost, and especially comparison with other competing technologies, this is happening tomorrow morning. I don't want to be over optimistic, but that's why, you know, now it seems to be very, it doesn't give a result now to invest, but nobody can afford not to do that now, you know, wisely, because otherwise they will be out of the train when the train finally sets off. And this is part of the mm-hmm. in my view, on the storage solution.
That is, there is no doubt that on what's our new website. But this also brings to the fact that that we have more component than in the new system than in the old one. So the decentralization of the system will bring many advantages, but it will bring also more complexity. So the need of be able to govern in some way, this complexity is important. So concerning price, we have the same, absolutely the same vision of Arnaud. I make this example because the example make clear how things are going fast. I say yesterday that in the summer 2022, Bloomberg, that is not a minor think tank, say that green hydrogen was going to be competitive in 2050, where we may get having the cost decline to $2 per ton. This was less than 2 years ago. Today is completely different. We are going to get less than $1 before 2030, and perhaps before that. And I give this example to emphasize what Arnaud said, that things are changing really fast concerning the costs. But at the same time, putting all these things together, so the interconnectivity, the flexibility of the grid, make it the grid balancing, this is not something that the market will solve alone. So we need a clear understanding on how the system may work. And we need policies, we need design, we need planning to make this happening in an economic way. We think that the cost will be not a problem. Technologies are changing day by day. It's impressive. Everything is changing so fast that, but still we need not only market, but harness the market, design the market, make policies that make insurance the full coherence in energy system that will be more complex than in the past.
So I hear from the panel a lot of optimism on green hydrogen and perhaps there's a huge debate, of course, on green hydrogen. There's a lot of uncertainties, different estimates on cost curves, of course.
Again, we have to be very careful because we come from a generation where we have read this, the economy of hydrogen. No? Hydrogen will be part of the system. It will be not the one solution. It will be a part of it. We estimate 14% in 2050 over the energy consumption and the energy market. So it's a strong, it's an important component, but it's one of the component of a more complex energy system that is coming.
Yeah, and we have a few questions on other renewable technologies. But since we opened the parentheses on hydrogen, and Arnaud is like, well, we haven't talked about hydrogen, so let's stay there. How do you gonna see the supply chain of hydrogen happening? Is it gonna be more localized, or is it gonna be concentrated in specific
countries slash regions, and then moved more on a longer routes, perhaps by ship, perhaps by pipeline, towards the industrial clusters. So what's your sense of potential scenarios? So what are we going to see?
I think if we talk about the supply chain of the spare parts of hydrogen production, there are the same issues there as they are on any other renewable type of supply chain, and also beyond renewables. I mean, you know, although it's getting a teeny bit better with the relative decrease in transport costs and everything, but
The molecule?
What I think that's what I wanted to answer. I think, you know, one of the issues in hydrogen is that you need a lot of renewable energy to produce green hydrogen. And when you look at, you know, the world, you have some countries that have a lot of natural resources in terms of renewable natural resources, lots of land, lots of sun, lots of wind. And some countries, and those countries are often not very densely populated. And reversely, and you know, they are mostly from the global south, as we now call it. So you have also some other countries that are the exact opposite, you know, whether it's the US, Europe, Japan, etc., where you have already, in most cases, a lot of renewable energy, a lot of the renewable energy potential used for energy, and it's very densely populated. You have, in some cases, and here in Spain we're lucky, but in some cases you have good renewable natural resources, but not always. And so this is why, and again, you know, the technology is not yet done, and even if it was, it's expensive, etc. But again, you know, sharing this optimism that we put out 5 minutes ago, this is where the concept of hydrogen valleys, where, you know, you have some countries, it allowed some countries from the global south also to kind of get noticed on the renewable scale. I mean, example is Namibia, for instance, which has started to be part of a number of alliances with countries very far away to promote their potential as a hydrogen valley. I was back, I'll give you another example, was back probably 9 months ago from a big tour of clients in Australia. And I was very stunned to see that every single Japanese energy-related company, whether it's Japanese trading houses, Japanese utilities, etc., they have all opened an office, but it's not a representative office. They're really strongly present now in Australia to make use. I mean, you know, there's no better example in terms of large country, loads of renewable natural resources, and not very densely populated than Australia. So this is starting to happen. There's plenty of technological obstacles that are being overcome one after the other. But I think, you know, this is, in a way, I don't want to use grand words and grand ideas, but I think this hydrogen thing, if and when we get it right, will redesign a little bit the, you know, you call it supply chain, the sort of energy routes, you know, globally.
So on this, we have published a couple of reports on trade. What we think that the market of hydrogen would be less global than the fossil fuel markets. So that we think that market will be more at the regional level, mm-hmm. In the medium term. This for a very understandable fact that the main cost for hydrogen are renewables, then the electrolyzer, and then the transport. So the longer you transport, the less competitive you will be. The cost of transport will be not very high, but nevertheless, we think that the market will be mainly regional. It will be half enough concerning pipelines or concerning ships.
This is what at least would come from our report. And what we are calling, we also published very recently a report with UNIDO and ILO, that we hope that the developed country first use hydrogen for their internal use, domestic use or regional use, and then they can export. So that's we change the trend that's actually there. So that if you want to work for a more inclusive, fair world, then that we call for them to use their hydrogen they produce for themselves, and then they can start selling to other. And the landscape will change. Now we see Namibia has already contracted with Germany, as Chile, as Uruguay. This I think that's it will last for a certain number of years, and then the regionalization of the market will happen inevitably. But it's good.
Yeah, at the end of the day, it's about land availability, resources availability, and technological cost of electrolyzers coming down, and that should make it a bit more democratic in some sense. So there's probably more places in the world where...
I think the electrolyzer will cost the same in all parts of the world. What will change is the way we produce electricity, so the cost of renewables and the cost of the logistic. This will make the difference. At the end, we think that many actors will be on the market. This is a good thing, because the market will be closer to a competitive market, not as is today. And that's a good thing. So many actors and the regionalization of the market themselves.
I mean, yeah, I don't disagree with regionalization. I mean, because people always have to follow the path of least resistance, right? So you will start shipping your electricity when it becomes possible to the closest country. But then, you know, it's probably likely, I'm not sure if it's medium term, long term, whatever, but it's likely to sort of, you know, go wherever it's needed at some point. But, you know.
Yeah, naturally, the crisis in Ukraine make everyone trying to get everything from everywhere. And then things will go back to the normal.
Which has in turn accelerated all what we're talking about, including the decrease in cost and the moment when hydrogen becomes more cost competitive.
Since we are still in the technology parenthesis, and then I promise I'm gonna close it, but related to other renewable gases, we have a question. We talk about green hydrogen. What about biomethane or other sort of renewable gases? The question is very broad. It's asking what would be the role? Is it going to be relevant, niche? How do you see the development of other renewable gases?
I can respond one letter. Relevant.
What did you say?
Relevant.
Relevant.
I agree. No, but I mean, it's a little bit everything we've been both saying since the beginning. We need every aspect of, you know, every type of renewable energy, every country, every type of market mechanism to make it a success. I think, you know, we have so much to do in so little time. No, I mean, it's obvious what I'm saying, but that, you know, biofuels, biogas, renewable gases, as I think we call them, they would be a part of the setup. Will they be in size the biggest one? Probably not. I mean, you know, but I think they can help fix some issues. You know, they can be used in some hard to abate sectors more locally, and this is actually what's happening. I mean, you know, in a number of countries. I mean, here, Italy, Nordics, France is starting a little bit, but UK, you know, there's in Europe, there's like a lot of excitement on it because it's part of the solution.
So let's switch gears a little bit, because I think, especially as Europeans, we have a bit of a tendency of looking at our belly button, perhaps a bit too much. But at the end of the day, the transition is a global issue. We have to transition the world, also considering that most of the growth in emissions is happening outside of Europe, outside of the developed world, outside of North America, especially in the east, especially potentially in the south. I guess I'm not sure we like or not. Some people like, some people don't, these labels of global north, global south. But you know, I don't want to get into the semantics. We know what we're talking about, and what we're talking about is really a world that has two different speeds. No, a developed world that is heavily relying on a service-based economy. Emissions are decreasing, energy demand is decreasing, and the rest of the world where is actually quite the opposite. Still developing, manufacturing is growing, energy demand is growing, population is growing. Of course, the case of China, but especially India and potentially Africa, is pretty clear. So I guess the first question I have for you is, how do you see the relationship between these two worlds, no? These two worlds that are have different goals, different objectives. Of course, one is richer, one is poorer, one is needs its own development, and in some sense we need to respect that development, but that development comes at a cost. What's the overall sense that you have about the relationship between the North and the South? Of course, we had a few advancements in the last COP, but still a lot needs to be done. I don't know, what's the start?
No, that's what we say, that we need to rewrite the way the international cooperation works. So it's evident that the model that we have used has had not the impact that we may wish in terms of development, in terms of also driving the new energy system. You know, everyone is saying that, and I think Arnaud knows better than us, how this complaint of the high cost of money, especially on investing in Africa, no? Everyone is saying, oh, it's the cost of money is so high.
There's a number of issues investing in Africa, but.
In our point of view, is what I've tried to say briefly in my presentation, rewrite the way international cooperation works is give ownership to the country, no predatory approach, that has been the rule in the past, and take into account that we need something that we can use the word that we want, words that we want to use, Green Deal, we can use a Marshall Plan, and we can do what we want. But if you want Africa be developing and developing in a way that is consistent with the goal of keep the rise of the temperature, we have to collaborate in strengthening the infrastructure first. There is no other way, because you cannot have investors going there and invest money in producing electricity that they cannot put in the grid. And if they put in the grid, it's under the PPA, where the government is paid the tariff, but the government is not able to have the tariff back from the citizen. There is not a demand in terms of capacity to buy. So these are the leftists may call as the structural barrier. So if we don't overcome this barrier, the change will happen in 100 years. So we need the multilateral financial institution working on this. Naturally, also the multilateral financial institution, they have not the capacity themselves, because the request of investment is huge. But if there is a clear understanding of what they intended to do, I'm sure that private money will come also for the infrastructure. We have built an alliance of utilities around the world. We are going as IRENA to work on a regional basis, but it's possible to build a credible plan for enhance the infrastructure in Africa. We are curtailing renewables in Mali today, because there is no chance to sell the electricity that's produced. So this has to be changed. And this could be changed if the cooperation is oriented to work with the countries and intervene where the country themselves cannot do alone. This is, I think, the first step to do is working on infrastructure. In this country, if you want to intercept the economic growth that is there, but bring the economic growth and associated development to the building of the new energy system.
I think maybe to complement a little bit, we probably need a bit more infrastructure. I mean, we do need a bit more infrastructure in Africa everywhere. Now, if you look at where Africa is in terms of energy, I'm not even talking about renewable energy, but energy at the moment, you have 54 countries in Africa, and the 53 countries which are not South Africa in total have as much generation capacity as South Africa alone. And South Africa has its own issue like every country, and it's not, you know, so big in terms of generation capacity. There are power failures, et cetera, et cetera. So indeed, the non-South Africa, 53 countries of Africa have gone, have not developed fast enough, et cetera. Will we, and maybe we differ a little bit, Francesco, on that, will we be able, with all the support of the world, will we be able to make those 53 countries, or the whole of Africa, it's the same, jump to a system which is the same as in Global North countries, where, you know, the bulk of the electricity, whether it's conventional or renewable, is transported on lines, on the network, etc. Personally, I don't think so. And what we see as some of the innovative countries in Africa, what they started to do is essentially bypass the kind of all grid kind of religion a little bit. You know, you have a lot of, a lot in proportion of renewable, of distributed energy. You have the development of microgrids. You have a lot of those solutions. And I think hydrogen is part of the solution as well. You know, it's used also in a number of islands, not necessarily in Africa, to get electricity in places where it's quite difficult to get the lines constructed. So yeah, I think, you know, personally, we're talking Africa more than the entire global south, right? But personally, I think that we need a solution that helps, that relies on many different pillars and not only infrastructure. The other thing I would say in terms of cooperation, you know, I use Global North and Global South, unless you give me a better way to call them, Massimo. But the way the cooperation, I think, is quite interesting, and it has made some progress at COP28 as well, is the jet piece, which people don't usually know much about, which means Just Energy Transition Partnership. These are a few groups of Global North countries congregating and actually helping some specific countries from the Global South. And for now, you have only four. I mean, it was invented, I think, at COP26, so 2.5 years ago. But for now, you only have four in the world and two in Africa, between South Africa and between the Global North countries, and towards South Africa and Senegal is the other country that I'm sure there are some in discussion. But what is quite interesting in these mechanisms is that it promotes renewable energy, but it also put the onus on the countries to reduce their conventional generation. And unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on where you position yourself, there isn't that much conventional energy generation in Africa, so there isn't much to replace. So we need to invent, I think they need to invent, their own system.
You know, that's concerning the GAP. We have expressed some, now it's there for a couple of years. They started with Indonesia, other countries where they want to reduce the use of coal in favor of renewables. And this is one option.
we as IRENA, we talk of a slightly different option. That is what we have called the Accelerated Partnership for Renewable Energy in Africa, that was launched in the occasion of the Climate Summit last year in Nairobi, and was also presented by head of state in the COP28. So the difference in the approach is that first we have for now seven African countries that have committed to that join the partnership, and what's important, they've committed to go faster on renewables, so there is a strong political commitment. And we are working for plan for this country with them. So the first thing the first moment is the planning together. And I think that this is relevant. And we have from the other side, countries as in the GEP, but perhaps in a more structured way we wish to have it, is that we have Germany, we have Denmark, we have the UAE, and we have the United States, and we have open. We probably will receive the backup of the G7 in a few weeks from now. We have also offering to Spain to join this, and then we have also a little bit of governance of the process. So we have tried in our wishes to improve the idea, putting a first phase more calling for a planning, and this will help also in the new edition of the National Determinant Contribution to be presented next year. So putting these things together and then working on the implementation, saving a little bit of governance of the problem that could be assured through the fact that IRENA is taking the secretariat and they will work with the government, be as an intergovernmental entity. And this also provide planning, implementation, and a little bit of governance of the process. This is another innovative way to see how international cooperation may work. It seems going. The plan are quite close to be ready in the General Assembly that we will have in a few weeks. We will present the progress. I'm sure that other countries, African countries, will join. But they can join all if they have a high level, political level, the commitment to get some results. And so we will see. So we have two kind of approach that are working there. I hope that both they can produce results as all we wish.
I mean, it's great. I mean, all the initiatives to that purpose are great. I think what the good news is, you know, irrespective of the initiative, is that it's starting to be, and I think it's only starting to be an item really at the forefront of everyone's mind and preoccupation, right? And we see it. I mean, we were exchanging earlier that we both of us spent almost 2 weeks, 10 days at COP this year. And you know, when we were chatting with people, it was really getting to the forefront of their priorities. So then, of course, like everything, the danger is to have too many conflicting initiatives and how to coordinate. The coordination is always complicated, but this is obviously something that I'm sure loads of people are seeing not to happen.
One thing that I may wish to add, I don't know how many investors are with us today, but we have also organized this financial platform that is called Energy Transition Accelerating Financing Platform, ETAF, where we have now 13 partners, starting from the ASEAN Infrastructure Investment Bank. Then we have MASDA, this is the renewable agency of the UAE, the Abu Dhabi Fund for Development. We have Swiss Re, that is an insurance company. We have the European Reconstruction Development Bank. We have the HSBC. We have the Islamic Development Bank. We have the OPEC Fund provide funding. We have the Inter-American Development Bank. We have CABEI, and I hope I miss no one. We are talking with COFIDES, and we have a financial commitment that's for around 5 billion. That are not relevant because we can go beyond that. If we as IRENA, we are helping to have a robust pipeline of projects. And everyone can apply to this platform, also the private sector. Naturally for investing in least developed countries and in small islands. And they can apply not only for renewable energy projects, so solar, wind, geothermal, but also for the supply chain of. So they can present projects for investing in manufacturing in Africa, means solar, means blades, batteries. So these are opportunities that are linked to the APRA initiative that we have. We are discussing with the Spanish entities the way we can collaborate, enter into the platform. But if there is an investor here, I invite to Google ITAF IRENA, and you will see how it's possible to present project and how the system will work.
So we've been talking a lot about Africa. I think we don't talk a lot about India in the public debate, which is in a different stage. It's not underdeveloped, it's actually developing quite rapidly. Biggest country in the world from this year, still relying a lot on coal and really doesn't seem to have a lot of trajectory of moving towards renewables, at least probably it's the slowest of all the major areas. On the other hand, from Europe, we have this idea of the CBAM, carbon-based adjustment mechanism, to try to incentivize countries, manufacturing countries like India and China and others to speed up their transition. Do you think that's the right way to go? Or should we think about a different approach to make sure?
The index. No? You have the index.
They are very high on our index in solar, of course. No, but I mean, when you want to transition, I mean, when you want to increase the percentage of renewable energy in a country, you have to increase the capacity of renewable energy and decrease the capacity of conventional energy. This is math, right? So I think India is doing very well in increasing the capacity of renewable energy. I remember probably 7 or 8 years ago, I hadn't been in India for a while, and I went to see, a lot of developers that probably did not exist last time, 3-4 years before when I was last there. And I was absolutely surprised, but positively surprised, by the number of young entrepreneurs that have created enormous renewable startups, with several gigawatts of, several hundreds of megawatts of operational assets, several gigawatts of projects. And basically they were almost all at the same stage where they went as far as they could go on their own, and they were looking to get some external financing to develop their pipeline. And if you look at how they got, that was about 8 years ago. If you look at who has invested in India, it's really interesting. I mean, you have one or two not so positive story of global funds, global infrastructure fund, pension funds that have invested. But 99% of the large money manager, to kind of call them as a generic term, are looking at India, have invested gazillions of money in India. And, usually when you want to invest, when you're an infra fund, for instance, you want to invest in a country, you buy one platform or you invest in one platform, and you start investing in this country from that platform. It's not what's happening in India. You have a few of the funds that have 2-3 platforms, and as you said, becoming the largest country in the world, a lot of ground to cover, etc. But this is extremely popular. Now, the problem is they need to decrease the conventional energy. And that's why, I mean, but, you know, Francesco's mechanism is a good one, although it's focused on Africa, but I'm sure there's others stuff in India. That's why the JETP stuff is not bad, because it forces people, or, you know, there's no JETP if people do not commit, if the global South countries do not commit to reduce carbon. And there are discussions at the moment with India to have a JET partnership, and the issue that that the negotiations are facing is that they are not very keen to abandon or to decrease rapidly conventional energy, but also, I mean, you know, it needs to be replaced by something. So it's a bit of chicken and egg, but I think, you know, in my view, they are on the right track as well.
That's for sure that they will get their goal of net zero before the NDCs they have presented. So there is no doubt they will do faster than they have announced in Glasgow. The other thing is that India is one of the countries today where a lot of investors are going there for green hydrogen, because they want to use green hydrogen to decarbonize the heavy sector, cement, steel. And there are a lot of investors that are competing for investing there in green hydrogen. So that's a good piece of news too.
This is one of the most, just one of the most active markets globally on hydrogen, on renewables, etc. Should probably.
Since we're talking about relationship towards East and West, we have a few questions that seem to be on the mind of some people as well about dependencies. Pretty clearly, dependency on China seems to be, or it's clear to be a reality on specific basic technologies, solar modules, batteries, critical materials. Do you see that as a potential issue? How can we solve it? At the same time, from Europe, we're getting squeezed from the West as well with the American IRA, which is making their country much more competitive. And so it seems like we're perhaps falling behind between, squeezed between the East and the West for different reasons. How do you see the current situation, or do you think it's an issue or not, or how can we?
Dependencies are never a good thing. That's an obvious answer to the question. So to be dependent is something that should be avoided. But we cannot look at China as an enemy, no? Because it's thanks to them that we made the progress we did in renewables around the world. They provide panel a very low price. This has incentivized the deployment of renewables around the world. So that the material and the rare earth are not rare. They are everywhere. Materials could be a little bit different. There is a geographical distribution. But it's possible to work for overcoming the danger of dependency. And depends on what we are doing. So what do we do? I think Europe has all the chances and all the opportunities to become less and less independent. And here again, it will be not the market to solve the problem. There will be the policies that make possible the market to work in a certain direction. So I think the European Union took some step in this direction. We have provided, as an element of reflection, our report on the geopolitics of hydrogen, as we talk about the geopolitics of critical mineral and rare earth. I encourage you to read this report, and we will come in a couple of weeks with another report of the geopolitics of energy security. that I think that will be giving a different point of view than usual in looking at all this problem. So dependency is a matter of concern, but is not today something that we cannot overcome.
And I think maybe to cover your point on the US, Massimo, and the IRA, I think every region, every country has to play to their strengths, right? So, the question is, if there was a Europe-like IRA mechanism, does Europe have the same strength, the same industrial kind of background, certainly, but is the current situation of industry in Europe such that it would allow European countries to take full benefit of a similar mechanism? And I think, I mean, you know, it's a big question. And some industry players have concluded that the answer is no. It's their conclusion. I'm not saying yes or no, but and so I think the every region, if we consider US, Europe, East, you know, whether it's China or more East, needs to adapt to push their own strength forward and not look at what other places in the world are doing, and we want to do the same thing. I think this is quite important, and it's, you know, obviously this is where Europe as a geopolitical entity can be stronger than every European country separately.
And related to that, of course, you know, the dynamic within Europe, there is a global north and a global south and a regional north and a regional south, no? And the integration between the northern countries and the southern countries will be fundamental to achieve that kind of a unitarian approach. How do you see those dynamics going? Because pretty clearly we have demand in the north, we have wind in the north, we have solar in the south, less industrialization. So are we going to sort of try to find some common ground, that, or will we find some common ground or not? What's your take?
I think we're going slightly beyond renewable energy considerations here. But I would say, personally, I've always thought diversity is good if it's tackled in the right way.
That's a great consultant answer.
I wasn't born a consultant.
Right. Well, you became a great one, though. You became a great one.
We are working. I will be working now on a new report on the integration between Europe and our neighbor, the Africa. Naturally, in any study, there is something that you have in mind, but it should be the number to tell us if our idea is a correct one or not. But we think that the integration, not solely in the Europe, North, the South, but integration Europe, Africa, will save and will enhance the competitiveness of Europe. Competing on making things, the world go greener, is a good thing. So the US have their legislation. Also India, China, they have legislation on this area to incentivize in some way or to push for the building of the new energy system. The future in Europe, I think, is in integration with the African continent, with Central East Europe, Central Asia too. Now the agreements of offshore and onshore wind in Central Asia for Europe has been an idea or a vision that is there. So through integration, I think the Europe will save, it will enhance its competitiveness.
Very, very well. Thank you. We're about to close. We have 2 minutes. So let me ask you one final question about the future. And so imagine that we're going to hold this very same session in 2030. which by all means, hopefully we'll be able to, and you're invited already. So
it's to be alive.
We'll.
This could be already success in my interview.
So imagine we're
optimistic, but now this sounds very pessimistic.
It's exactly all of a sudden. <Let's go. laughs> All of a sudden. So imagine we're gonna have the same session in 5 years. What are gonna be the, you know, the achievements we'll be proud about, and what are gonna be the challenges that we'll be still be talking, or the new challenge we'll be talking.
The hope is not to have regret.
Not to have what?
Not having regret.
Oh yeah.
Oh, we should have done that. We didn't. If we did, we will be all in a good health, and we'll enjoy a glass of cava to congratulate ourselves on the result that we have achieved. I say cava, not champagne.
I heard that. I thought you would say Franciacorta or
something like that. No. That's, or, you know, politics is
or a prosecco, or a prosecco.
No, cava. Yeah, cava.
I mean, you know, I think what I expect, because as you understood, I'm the optimist, that we will be stunned by the speed at which what we were all predicting here today was going to happen, the speed at which it would have actually happened. And I'm not sure if this is what I expect or what I wish. It's probably both.
Well, I like Spanish because in Spanish the word, the verb esperar, means both to
wait
hope
and hope,
but also to wait, which sometimes the two things are very similar. No? So on that note, I wanna thank you. We are on time, which is incredible for having three talents on a panel being on time. it's pretty incredible. So join me in a round of applause to welcome our panelists.
I just want to say, because I think Francesco has done a much better job than me at promoting his reports. If you guys want our RECA report, it's easy, ey.com/RECAI. And you can also send me a mail, whatever, if you want to get registered on it. Because I cannot register anyone out of authority because of kind of regulation, GDPR.
We can probably try to distribute both your material to the whole audience, so because they're all very interesting, and I'm sure there's, you know, a lot of people are going to be interested to have more time. Right. We pass the word to Rafael Villaseca from the Naturgy Foundation for a closing. Shall we sit?
Many thanks.
We're going to stay here.
Muy rápido,
we're
only a few words. Muy buenos días a todos y muchas gracias por haber asistido a esta sesión número 15 de nuestros Energy Prospectives. Realmente no es solo una cuestión para los interesados en el mundo de la energía o de la empresa, es una cuestión capital para la sociedad actualmente, las consecuencias del cambio climático y claro, como consecuencia, por ende, la transición energética, el cumplimiento de una serie de hitos, metas que nos hemos marcado para cambiar la situación realmente seria en la que estamos ya padeciendo y podemos llegar a padecer en un futuro. Bien, el camino es muy complicado y seguramente no estamos yendo a la velocidad ni consiguiendo los hitos que queremos. Me viene a la mente el reciente y dramático llamamiento del secretario general de la ONU al respecto. No estamos consiguiéndolo, si bien no hay duda de que hay muchas iniciativas en marcha, en muchas cuestiones que deben dar respuesta a este reto que afrontamos todos globalmente. Dentro de estos retos que tenemos que cumplir y de lo que nos proponemos hacer, ninguna duda de que las energías renovables son uno de los instrumentos fundamentales que hoy por hoy contamos para hacer frente a este reto que tiene la humanidad y que tenemos todo. Sabemos de la enorme importancia e interés que tienen las energías renovables y también conocíamos hoy mejor cuáles son las dificultades que está enfrentando para conseguir un pleno desarrollo y una eficacia para luchar contra los retos que nos hemos impuesto por necesidad y por interés, las dos cosas a la vez. Por eso ha sido enormemente interesante poder escuchar a las dos personalidades que hoy nos han acompañado, cómo ellos ven el desarrollo de las energías renovables y las dificultades que tienen que superarse para que realmente tengan toda la eficacia que nos proponemos. Yo quisiera agradecer, many thanks for both for your speech. That has been really interesting. Y sin duda alguna marcarán el futuro de todas las empresas y de todos los interesados en el mundo de la energía. Solo me resta agradecerles de nuevo su presencia aquí y la del profesor Moré, que nos ha moderado este acto. Y ya despedirme recordándoles que nuestra próxima sesión del Energy Prospectives tendrá lugar el 19 de junio y contamos con la presencia de Joseph Stiglitz, el premio Nobel, y de José Manuel Durao Barroso, que fue presidente de la Comisión Europea. Nada más, repetirles las gracias a nuestros ponentes y moderador y a todos ustedes por su presencia hoy aquí. Hasta otra ocasión.